And we are live here at Harebrain Scheme Studio in beautiful, non-sunny Seattle. This is the Harebrain Scheme's BattleTech Livestream Developer Q&A. My name is Mitch Gittleman. I am the nominal leader of Harebrain Schemes, along with my beautiful, wonderful partner, creator of BattleTech, Jordan Weissman, who I adore. And with me is Christopher Eck, tools developer for Harebrain Schemes and for BattleTech. Say hi, Chris.
Hello, everyone.
There we go. And in case you didn't know what's going on BattleTech.com forums, BattleTechGame.com forums, we let people know that Chris was going to be joining us for the first half of the show, and we got a whole bunch of questions from him. And so for the first half hour, we're going to talk to Chris, and then the second half hour, Mike McCain, the game director for BattleTech, and Tyler Carpenter, one of our designers, will again join us, and then we will take questions live from chat. Now, why do we have Christopher Eck here in the studio with us? In case you don't know, Chris was a BattleTech backer.
I was.
And when we said we were looking... What's that?
I still am.
So, oh, good point. And when we said that we were looking for tools developers, Chris actually sent in his job description. So I thought we actually have a BattleTech backer on the team now, which I think is pretty cool because he gets the inside scoop and all the cool swag. So so I thought we'd start by just asking, before we get to your questions, Chris, tell us about your history with BattleTech.
All right.
And what's your story, man?
Well, first I got into BattleTech, I guess, when I was about 13, so a long time ago, 27 years ago. And
you're a programmer, so you can do math. That's good.
Yeah. Let's see. Just played a ton of BattleTech throughout high school and college. Every single BattleTech game, video game, MechWarrior, Crescent Hawk's Revenge,
yes.
All the early
stuff. You haven't
stuff,
said Mech Commander yet.
Mech Commander.
There we go.
Mech Commander 2.
All right.
Mech Commander cutscenes, awesome.
Thank you. Mech Commander Gold, did you ever play Desperate Measures?
I don't think
I did. Oh, that was actually a good campaign. Let me see if I can hook you up with that.
Cool.
Yeah.
So lots of BattleTech history, and then... I became a backer for the BattleTech thing and for the BattleTech game, and they were hiring a tools developer position, and I was in Tennessee at the time, and my wife said, "You need to apply for that." I was like, "They're not going to hire me. It's pointless to waste my time with it."
And why did you think we weren't going to hire you?
Well, because I didn't really have games industry experience.
Mm-hmm.
I was remote in Tennessee and just... It's really hard to get into the game industry in general.
That's true.
Because there's plenty of applicants out there.
That's true.
Supply and demand. And so, but I sent it anyways because I knew if I didn't, I'd regret it.
Yeah.
And
no, that makes sense. You've got to.
And then they called me back and nailed the phone interview. Then I flew up here to do the in-person thing. And it just went really well and everything fell together. And they hired me, which was awesome.
And as I recall, Jordan was in your interview loop, right? Did you get interviewed by Jordan?
I don't think I did.
What was it like the first time that you met Jordan?
That was really cool. It was. I tried not to nerd out about it, but he sat down the row for me, and and just I just tried not to be a geek about it. But it's always been really cool, and I've got to play BattleTech with him. I've got to play other board games with him. I even got to cut the line at the BattleTech pods and play with him there at Gen Con, and it's been really cool. He's a great guy.
And he is terrible at the BattleTech pods.
He's not great.
The only person actually worse than Jordan in the studio that has ever played the BattleTech pods is me.
Okay.
By the way, I'm actually bad at every BattleTech game ever made, although I've played most of them. All right, so let's get to questions from the forums. Here we go. Here we go. Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts, or is it Seattle's best? What's the story?
Actually, I had to give up caffeine because I've been messing with computers since I was 7, so they told me to cut out red meat, caffeine, refined sugars, and saturated fat, or stop playing computers. So I gave up most of those things.
Wow, well, that explains your girlish figure. Okay. All right, so for people out there who don't know, especially, because there's a lot of people that don't really get the behind the scenes of game development, can you define, at least here at Harebrain Schemes, what is a tools developer? What do you do?
Well, the game company makes the game, and as a tools developer, I make the tools to make the game. So I do things like automate repetitive tasks. I do things like modify third-party assets to suit exactly what our needs are. And then I also make things like the map editor or other tools that just let the game happen.
So what's interesting is for most of the team, sort of the customer for our work is you.
Yes.
But for Chris, the customer for your work is the rest of the team.
Yes.
That's interesting.
Yeah, so pretty much what I do is I try to listen to who's complaining the loudest and then go see what I can do to make their lives better.
And who complains the loudest?
Depends on the day.
That was very nicely put, because you got to go back into that room with
people. They might be watching.
All right, so that's cool. And what was the hardest tool that you've had to make so far?
Probably the hardest thing was getting the map data to live in this weird state, because we're going to have a non-Unity server, but all the map tools are in Unity. So I had to, I wrote three different serialization things, and then Dave wrote one, and then Julie wrote one that we're finally sticking with. And just getting Unity to play nice with not Unity has been a nightmare. And we still break the build with, because there's all these compiler directives that say, hey, in Unity do this, and not Unity do that.
Well, let's go the opposite way then. That was the biggest challenge for you, and it sounds like it's kind of an ongoing challenge, at least for the engineering team. But which tool are you happiest or proudest with
Let's see. I think the dynamic logic that lets designers, without too much programming background, what they get to do is they can listen to certain messages, then they can wire up certain events and write custom logic to make fun and interesting encounters. So
as an example, this is a classic thing from video games. I'll simplify. You know, you walk your mechs into an area, and then a voiceover comes up and says, you know, you've reached the drop zone, commander. It's like, uh-oh, we have incoming, right. You know, incoming enemy. And then you trigger the incoming enemy and their logic. Is that about accurate?
But rather than having just one device that does that,
right.
It's more dynamic. They can listen to whatever messages that we're publishing. They can listen to actors getting killed or whatever, and then write whatever custom logic that they want.
Yeah. No, perfect. You enable creative people to do their jobs.
Yep.
Bravo. Yay. And by the way, thank you.
Yes, sir.
All right, what do we got here? Which development group do you find yourself working with the most? That would be animation, level design, blah, blah, blah.
At first, it was mostly artists and doing pipeline automation things and getting the map tools or the actual terrain editing stuff working. But lately, I've been dealing with the game designers themselves and working hard to get the map design tools or the encounter logic and all the game actually going.
Yeah, it's interesting. What happens is, you know, when you start making a game, you think, okay, we need this set of tools in order to create the sort of, especially, you know, the single player experience that we're looking for. And then as the game goes on, as game development goes on, what happens is you realize as you're playing it, wouldn't it be cool if?
Oh, yeah.
Right? Which is both the greatest thing about game development and the worst thing about game development, depending on where in the process you are, where in the schedule you are. Because wouldn't it be cool if, right now, is one of the hardest things to manage. It's like, yes, that would be cool. No, we shouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Or, yes, that would be cool. What do we have to trade that out for?
Mm-hmm.
And that sort of judgment is what makes a good game development studio. Okay, we'll keep going. We already covered some of this. You already talked about not having a prior game development experience. So what kind of development experience did you have?
Well, technically, my very first job was a game development position. I made slot machines, video poker machines, and things like that.
All right, real fast. People are asking me to stop the autofocus because we're sort of weaving a little bit. And the truth is, right now the team is doing their stand-up scrum every day, and I have no idea how, so please be patient, and when they come back in, I'll have somebody fix it.
I'll try to sit still.
Yeah, let's do a little of this. Hello. All right, go ahead, man.
Okay, what was the question?
Oh, I don't fucking know. All right, let's try again. Your prior experience.
Oh, yeah. Mostly it was, I did have that first job, but that was so long ago and with technology that we're not using anymore. So, no, I didn't. I did have lots of hobby experience with game development and just working on my own stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But mostly it was just business development, C#, SQL, and my last big job was writing licensing software for the state of California.
Good Lord.
So, but I mean, I love programming and it was a fun job for me. There's a lot of similarities between just business development and game development. But
yeah,
with game development, I can actually show people what I did and they can be impressed by it.
That's the big difference for you?
Yes. Getting to see big, huge mechs shoot the crap out of each other is a lot cooler than saying, oh yeah, and they were able to merge these two customers efficiently.
I see that. I see that. Not to downplay, you know, other people's work. You know, we are very, very lucky, and we just have to acknowledge that we're very, very lucky. You know, what's it like working in a game studio? What's the difference, sort of culturally, between where you came from and where you are now?
Surprisingly, we were less HR oriented than we are here.
What does that mean?
Because
there are HR violations pretty much every day here.
Yeah, I know, but we were bad where we came from.
Oh, yeah. So, oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
But let's see. Differences, the honesty with the leadership is way better. We know exactly what's going on. They report kind of what's happening, and that's just very refreshing. Let's see some other differences.
Actually, I think that was one of the reasons why we hired you in the first place. This is a known thing. But, you know, when Chris came in for his interview, obviously I can't judge his coding ability. You know, I just rely on Chris Ardapple, our lead engineer, for that and stuff. What I'm looking for when I'm looking to add somebody to a studio is fit, right? Mm-hmm. That's just the way it works. There's a human algebra to making video games or any sort of creative output, right? You want to make sure the right people are in the right places and that they understand collaboration, they understand how to actually communicate, you know? And so that's what I look for. And that's really my job on an interview, what we call a loop, you know, as you go through all these people. And the thing that impressed me most about Chris that he proved pretty much his first week here is he was honest, right? And that's what you're looking for. And Chris asks hard questions and he has no problem asking them. And as a studio manager, I adore that, because what you don't want are shrinking violets who just keep to themselves and what we call terrible eyes, mm-hmm. you know, where it's like left without information, people often, you know, insert the worst scenario possible. And so it's up to occasionally people like Chris to ask the hard questions for everybody to get the answer all at the same time. So it's actually a service both to the studio and to me personally. Does that make
cool.
sense?
Yeah.
So that's what I saw. And then like your very first week here, I fired somebody and you started asking hard questions about why I fired him.
Yep.
And it's like, okay, those are the answers.
I had just moved across the country and given away most of my stuff, so
yeah.
I wanted to know.
Yeah, it makes total sense. And you know, hopefully the answers made sense to
they
you.
They did.
All right, good. We move on. Back to the questions that you put on battletechgame.com. That's battletechgame.com. That's our forums. We invite you to join us there. There's a really great community there of really cool people. It's a safe place where you're not going to get jumped on just because you're a filthy cheating clanner or something like that.
There's a couple of BattleTech nerds there, just disclaimer.
There may be some BattleTech nerds on BattleTechGame.com, including us.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, No Guts, No Galaxy. That's BattleTechGame.com. Okay, back to your questions. Turning a hobby into a job can be a very sobering experience. What was it like for you to turn BattleTech fandom into a job?
It was a little bit scary, because to do that, I had to uproot my family.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a Sheldon-esque fear of change. So that I had that going for me. And I had lived in Tennessee for about 40 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I had to do that. I had to move up here and just get completely just in way outside my comfort zone. And I had to do that on the hope that the job was going to be cool, because yeah. In an interview process, I'm trying to sell myself and the job's trying to sell it like it's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
But you never know until you get in there to to see if it's any good. But
yeah.
In this case, it really turned out well. I love the job. The people here are awesome. They're very passionate. I don't feel like there's any dead weight on the team.
That's really nice. Thank you for that.
I mean, it's just a lot of great people are pouring their hearts and souls into this game, and we're having lots of fun doing it. And it's just been amazing. It's been everything that I hoped it would be. Do I recommend everybody try to do that? No, because it's a lot of game development jobs. You'll be just churned through. There's just high turnover, and with supply and demand, there's plenty of people that are willing to do that job for less and for longer hours. So if the studio is right, sure, but if you just think I'll be happy making any game, I don't think that would be true.
Yeah, that makes sense. Has it changed the way you feel about BattleTech?
I've always loved BattleTech, so no. Yeah. I mean,
no.
This was an opportunity to work on a dream game, like some part of my childhood. I have a big, huge MechWarrior Mercenaries 2 cut out from one of the game stores.
Yeah.
I think there was a picture of me earlier
yeah.
with all my BattleTech gear. So
yeah, I love that stuff.
This was a dream job for me, and I had to take it.
And the other thing that happened when Chris joined us is, you know, we've got a weekly BattleTech live streaming role-playing game called Death from Above,
yep.
Which is every Friday night on HyperRPG. That's twitch.com/HyperRPG.
This Madcaps, he's a smart fella.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. So Chris joined the show, and he's a recurring guest star as a light mech specialist and
yep.
spook.
Yep.
And what's your character name again?
Lazarus.
Lazarus.
Call sign Lazarus.
Yeah. And Chris, what's cool about it on the show for me, which was fun, was I got to put him into one of the very first Ravens ever
yeah.
in BattleTech, nice. Right? Fictionally, in our side logic fiction or whatever. It's like, you know, Mitch's imaginary tale and Mitch, mm-hmm. Mitch and Tyler's. And so he got to pilot a Raven. That's why I brought him this today. Look at this.
Oh.
He's got a Raven. Oh, look, autofocus actually worked. So this is for
yeah.
you. Next time you're on the show, you should wear that.
That is awesome.
Right?
Thank
cool.
you.
Yeah. So there, that's for you. Enjoyed that. And by the way, you were a fucking killer in that Raven. I've never seen anybody pilot a Raven so effectively before. So, and that's without any of the real
yeah.
you know, electronic countermeasures and stuff. Mm-hmm. That was just really solid playing. So it's nice to have a good player on the team. let's see. How did the Unity update, which we talked about in our Kickstarter update a while ago, and the whole delay of beta, how did the Unity update affect you personally?
Oh, yeah. That wasn't too bad for me. The problem with the Unity update wasn't any kind of game performance. It was actually editor performance.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened was maps were loading slower. Games were...
You push a button.
Yeah.
In the editor, you would push a button saying, okay, do this.
Yeah, and then I want to play test the scene, and it was taking minutes and minutes. And you make a small change, and then, oh, you forgot to click one thing, so you have to cancel out of that. But you have to wait for it to finish. And so it was just... I had to do some performance profiling and lock down some things that we weren't doing right, and Unity started calling into more often.
Right, exactly. So... You know, it's really not, I think it's important to note that we're not really calling out Unity like Unity sucks in this case.
Absolutely.
It's
not.
The way that Unity was interacting with our game logic. Mm-hmm. Makes sense?
Yeah.
But, yeah, and so that was a lot of the work. It was just tracking down what had happened,
mm-hmm.
right? And, you know, we've done Unity upgrades many, many, many times in the history of harebrained schemes, and nothing like this to this level has ever happened
yeah,
to us before. So we gave it all the time that we normally give, you know.
That happened when we were changing source control servers, when we were changing source control software, and it was just
I think
a perfect storm of issues.
Right. A technical term for that is clusterfuck. Yeah, that's okay. You've been in the industry still a very short amount of time. Clusterfuck maybe hasn't reached your
I'll know for
lexicon
next time.
yet. There you go. Sharing is caring. What's the difference between the developer tools and consumer tools? And why can't we have a mission? Let's just go to this one. Why can't we have a mission editor versus a map editor or mech editor? Well, first of all, let me just take the mech editor thing. You will have a mech editor. You
yeah.
will have Mech Lab in the game. It's going to be fun. You know, we've already got it working, right? It's not ready to go yet. It's ready for internal testing and that kind of thing. It doesn't have real art to it. It's just that sort of bare bones
yeah.
sort of, here's what a drop-down list looks like. And so it's really ugly, but that is working.
We call it a developer user interface
Thank
because
you.
A developer did it instead of a UI guy.
Yeah, which means it's fugly.
Yes.
So that's another technical term that you could add to your lexicon
right.
later,
right
fugly.
Now.
Right? You're not taking notes. That's okay.
Okay.
You can go back to YouTube later and get this.
So yeah. why can't you have the one that we have? There's a couple of reasons. One is the requirement I was given is it has to be in the Unity editor so that everybody's always in Unity. And so for me to provide that to you guys, to everyone, would be you'd get all of our source code, you'd get every single third-party tool distributed with that we're using that we're not allowed to distribute, and you would also get all of our assets and everything.
Hey,
so,
McCain's here.
Hey, so we're giving everybody all the code.
That's right. That's what you just heard. Thanks for that. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to Michael McCain. He is the game director for Battletech dot whatever.
But other things are just like
just let that go.
Quality,
anyway, back to you, Chris.
Quality and support issues. There's things in there where I say, hey, if this happens, go grab Eck because it shouldn't be able to happen. So they'll come get me, and
yeah.
we'll try to figure out how to do things. Supporting it and just level of polish. It's just
so that's
it,
that's
it works,
one side,
but
of it.
It's
right.
fugly.
And then the other thing is, why don't we create a standalone mission or map editor tool to distribute like we did with the Shadowrun games? And I can tell you, and Mike can tell you from experience,
it's hard.
That's real hard. To be specific, with the Shadowrun Returns game, the very first one where we shipped our very first version of the mission editor, that took an engineer plus support the entire development process to create for you. And that was 1 year from beginning to end. One person did nothing but that. And that was a huge investment that, frankly, could have gone towards making a better game,
mm-hmm.
right? And so that's what we're doing here in this case, is making sure that the game we ship is as good as possible and is as, if you will, featureful. That's a new word. Featureful.
Yeah, and it's always.
Well, 1 second. Can you turn off the autofocus? Because we don't know.
Oh, yeah. People are asking. Yeah, okay.
This,
well, we'll just. Yeah, do you know anything?
I will investigate.
Do you know things?
But I'm going to go ahead and jump in on that, too.
All right, so just Mike's voice. I will do it.
Disembodied hands. Voice. You know what? It's probably on the.
Yeah.
It's hard to talk
Hey,
about
Chris, do you know how to turn off autofocus? Chris says no. All right, sit your ass down. All right, so for everybody that unfortunately has a problem with autofocus, we love you, but you're not going to get what you want. So if we could just sit a little still and not do some of this stuff. I know, it's cool. Eventually I'll do this. This is what you do when you hit the brake too hard on your daughter. It's like, no, it's not. That's how you break your arm. So, Mike, you were talking about the...
Yeah, every project's different. Too,
yeah, without a doubt.
You know, moving to full 3D, we felt like had a ton of benefits for Battletech to really show off the scale of the action and the mechs. But on the flip, like that's, I guess, sorry, backing up. What I mean is like 2D presentation was one of the things that made the Shadowrun editor actually work fairly well for that title, like scope aside and the tight constraints that we were under aside, that's a much more abstractable environment to sort of represent in an out of Unity editor and then to see the same thing inside of Unity.
Right, back to the Eck. We've got him for another 5 minutes. All right. Let's see. Coming in to work in the morning, what do you look forward to the most?
Let's see. These couple of questions ask, like, what's the first thing I do in the morning and what's the last thing that I leave for the next day? And one of the things that it's really cool about my job is that it changes every day. What I'm doing is I'm a problem solver and I solve problems, and whatever problem needs solving, that's what I'm working on. It's really nice.
Yeah.
About the only consistent thing that I do every day is I make the coffee in the morning, and Pam tells me she loves me, and I really like that.
Yeah, no, that's a great way to start your day, without a doubt.
Coffee's important.
And so is Pam. So there. Pam's our office manager. Okay, now, because we only have 4 minutes left, I'm going to go into sort of an Eck lightning round.
Oh,
all right. Okay. I'm just going to start asking you questions and see if you can peel off some answers. You ready to go? Now,
are there any embarrassing ones?
I mean, no. I should have said that. How long does it take you to grow a beard?
Way too long.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Is the does
like
the chest
5 or
hair
6 days
match?
I don't have very much chest hair.
Is that right?
Yep.
You want some?
No, thank you.
Because I got gray. I can give you.
I'm good.
All right. Cool. All right. Here we go. So, what's your favorite battle mech of all time?
Probably the Warhawk.
Tell us why the Warhawk in particular, Chris.
Because I wish I could have gone into more detail about why I like the clans, but now people will just think I'm a big cheeser. So I'll answer that on the forums. But anyways, I had such awesome luck on one fight where I took out four guys, and this other guy showed up to finish me off.
Right.
And I said, he jumped right next to me, and I said, I'll offer you Hagira. And he said, what's that? I said, that's where I let you leave the field of battle without any loss of honor. You just concede that I'm the better warrior. And he flipped out. He unloaded everything. And
you are a planner. Oh, my God.
And he proceeded to hit every location, and I wound up with, like, 2 points of external armor on my rear still.
Really?
And then I killed him.
And then I killed him. Bravo. So what else did you say? Battletech faction.
I picked up the Clan Smoke Jaguar Mantle on Tukiid because we were going through the scenario book and nobody wanted to play Clan Smoke Jaguar. And I said, give me that. I'll play Clan Smoke Jaguar. And then I proceeded to do sweeping victory after sweeping victory.
But there's Clan Smoke Jaguar's got a very specific feel to it.
Yeah.
So what attracted you specifically to
it? It's not really the feel. They are a bunch of space Nazi assholes. But they do have some really cool warriors. Like the first guy on Tukiid was an elemental that just wouldn't trigger his jump jets, and he just rocketed straight down because he wanted to be the first. And so he lands and breaks his back, both his legs, and then he gets juice full of combat drugs, and that's just that's
and
awesome.
This attracted you to Clan Smoke Jag. What the fuck?
I picked it up because nobody else wanted it, and then I
Somebody's
was kind of stuck
Empire.
With it.
And so you got to fight Clan Smoke Jaguar in Mech Commander 1.
Yeah.
Battle of Port Arthur.
Yep.
Just saying. Mad Cat Jaguar, Mad
but
Cat.
If I was going to identify with any of them, it would probably be Clan Wolf. I really like the Ulrich Kransky.
That makes more sense
and
to
how
me.
How he was just like the brains behind the whole operation. It was really nice.
No, knowing you, I was like, why aren't you saying Wolf? all right, cool. This is a good one. I like this one. What would your dream Battletech game be? Let's just say that we have as much money as the GTA 5 team.
Okay.
All right. Where do you go?
If we have an unlimited budget, then I'd go pie in the sky. It'd never get made because no one would play it. But
irrelevant.
Me
go ahead.
And seven people. It'd be straight Battletech rules, tabletop, but everything, like the entire Inner Sphere. You would have to worry about loading up your dropships, jumping from point to point, getting the assets on the ground past their aerospace fighters, fighting naval battles with combined arms and tanks and all this other stuff. And you could fight any battle that you wanted.
Quad mechs?
Quad mechs. All right, quad mechs are there. Start in 3025 and then go from there.
Yeah.
But if we were going to go a more reasonable game, I'd think a kind of a Solaris 7 stable management game where you fight small-scale battles and level up your mech warriors.
Is this third person or first person you're talking about?
I do third person.
Okay. All right.
You know, he said all that, but what he really wants is the Hatchet Man.
I would like a Hatchet Man, but I'm working on a couple of deals, but I don't think it's probably going to happen.
Let's see what we got
yet.
Not yet.
In success.
Oh, well, there's success and there's, well, Hatchet Man. Yeah, okay. That's a reasonable level of success.
Success, all things.
You know, whenever I hear anybody saying the Battletech game of their dreams, it's all about some people playing from a command structure, command point of view, while other people are on the battlefield, and everybody has some what we call asymmetrical gameplay to do. So a lot of that. All right. Yeah, thanks. Yeah, that was totally a promise, what we just said. By the way, this is for you. Okay, let's see. Favorite type of mech pilot, clan, pirate, merc, loyalist? Where are you?
I think it would actually be mercenary, to be honest. I like the mercenary lifestyle. I mean, I love the militaristic background of the clans and things like that. But when I'm playing, I think I most like worrying about the money and buying stuff and upgrading mechs and all that. All that fun stuff that you wouldn't really get with clan playstyle.
Hmm. All right, we're going to keep rolling through here and get you out of here. Is it true Tyler is worse at the in-house beta than Mitch?
I'll let Mitch answer that.
There is.
No, I'm going to answer that. No.
Are you number three still on the leaderboard?
Yeah, I'm number three.
Tyler's... Prepare to be boarded, motherfucker.
Oh.
So
challenge accepted.
Yeah, the answer really though is I am second to worst in the studio.
I'll post the
you will not.
ELO ranking.
You will not. You will not. It was really good having you here. do you agree that a game's atmosphere is more critical than gameplay? That was kind of a loaded question from the fan. By the way, we don't deal with your binary bullshit here. But go ahead, answer the question.
No, I do not agree with that. I grew up on text-based games and old-ass things where you move your red action square to acquire the green treasure square.
Bravo.
And for me, gameplay is way more important than atmosphere. That being said, our game is very beautiful. It's pretty. It's awesome.
I also am really excited about the cutscenes that we're making and the story that we're telling. So, oh, and also John Everest music. John Everest couldn't join us this month, but we'll try and get him. But Everest is doing a beautiful job, as is Rob Pearsall, our audio director. They're doing great stuff. And I just want to shout out to our man Will, our special effects artist, also is doing a great job. So, on that note, how long did it take you to assemble the Paper Leopard dropship for DFA last year? And show the kids.
I'm going to mess with the autofocus here. Hopefully, it's not too bad.
Yeah, you can do it. Yeah, go ahead, get closer. There we go. Look at that. It worked.
We got the Mason's Marauder logo on it.
Damn
on the
right.
Wings. We got the little turret that turns.
So how long did it take you to make that?
I believe it took me a lot longer than I thought.
You're an engineer.
It's two to 3 hours, maybe three or four, something like that.
It was so fun to have that on the finale. That was great. And I got to tell you, I miss gallivanting around the universe doing whatever I want as opposed to being on that fucking planet.
Yeah, I downloaded some little PDF kit that lets you do that, so I'll try to link that in the forums.
Yeah, you should. That would be great. I bet people would love that. All right, well, let's say goodbye to Chris Eck. We have run out of time. Beautiful job. Thank you for joining our studio. Take your Raven patch. See you on the battlefield, as they
say.
All right. Cheers, everybody. Say goodbye to Chris.
One last thing. Happy birthday to my friend Jason Duncan.
There we go. Duncan. How old's Duncan?
Happy birthday, Jason. I don't know.
All right.
I don't know.
Thanks, Chris.
All right. So it's just you and me?
It's just you and me.
All right.
Just you and
me. Tyler's here. All right.
Tyler Carpenter, ladies and gentlemen, pull your chair over. All right. So we got McCain over here. If you're just joining us, he's the game director for BattleTech. Tyler Carpenter, who is one of our designers and who is also the game master on Death from Above every Friday, 6 p.m. on twitch.com/hyperRPG. How'd I do?
Technically, I'm also a backer that became an employee. I was just a Shadowrun Returns backer.
And can I get a hell yes? Oh, hell yes. Hell yeah. Woot. All right. So much for that. We are now in this mode, and I'm going to do it this way because I have to see it. And Tyler is, as they said right here, Krellen is a dapper man. Dapper man.
Fact.
All right. I do my best. One thing, as you're probably being told, put the word question in brackets before your question. If I don't get your question, please just repost it and don't feel like you're being irritating or anything. This thing scrolls incredibly fast. And eventually I'll tell you know what, I'm not going to answer that question. So there it is. All right, here we go. Question, did you hire an IT guy yet? Yes!
About time.
He starts when?
Friday.
He starts Friday. His name is Sean. I'm already in love with him because he's an IT guy. All right. And also, we just had a new tester join the team also. Her name is Jen Bowe, and I used to work with her at Microsoft. She's an ass kicker, so happy to have her on the team, too. All right, here we go. Mitch, as a lead producer, do you interview potential candidates to work on the game, or do you kidnap them when they are at their weakness? Again, with your binary thinking, there's another way of doing that, too. I slip them a Mickey.
little hypnosis and mentoring candidate stuff.
Something. Well, speaking for myself, I was Stockholmed into the studio several years ago.
Go ahead. Tell them how that worked.
Well, no, I was a contractor, and then, as a contractor, doing a little bit more.
Do you remember, one of our first conversations, I said to you, Mike, I just want to warn you, I have fired 7 art directors, and please don't be the 8th.
High five.
Stockholm.
High five on not being fired.
So far, so good.
That's an absolutely true story, and that number is also absolutely true. So, is that patch you gave Ek a preview of upcoming BattleTech gear? No. That is old BattleTech gear that was actually given to me by a fan, and I wanted to give it to Ek. That's old. I don't know where you can find. That was a Foster Brooks moment right there. And by the way, I'm not drunk. But no, that's not BattleTech gear that's coming. In the last Q&A, Tyler told us that you're looking at making extremely slow mechs like the Irby a bit faster and extremely fast mechs like the Locust a little bit slower. Can you tell us something of the scale of those changes? No.
I don't remember the math for it. That's really why I can't tell you, because
it's just curved off a little bit.
Yeah. It's just bell curving.
None of this is dramatic. The important thing, if I may interject here, is that the nature of each battle mech we maintain.
Oh, yeah.
That's absolutely the important thing. They have character.
The Locust is still the fastest little bugger that goes explodes when you breathe hard.
Yeah, to give it another analogy, an X-Wing's an X-Wing, a Y-Wing's a Y-Wing,
yep.
A B-Wing and an A-Wing, which was created. A-Wing was actually created for the West End role-playing game and then got back.
Interesting.
And the Locust is an A-Wing with all the armor stripped off.
All right. Question, can you tell everybody on the team that I love them? I gotta tell you, I do that almost every day. Well, I say that I love them, but yes. Totally serious BT feature request, Sokolov dating simulator. We'll take that offline. Put that on the DFA forums. You never know what AJ can come up with. Here's a question. I know you're going to hate this. When is beta? We don't hate that question. We ask ourselves that every day. Mike will answer the question now. Go ahead, Mike.
Not this month.
Not this month. But I will say this, and Michael will be like, what are you about to say? We have a plan. We are executing on that plan. And when we are confident in a date, we'll tell you.
Man, the way you said we have a plan, I was like, are there many copies?
Thank you.
Am I one?
Thank you. Yeah. Two riders were approaching, and the wind began to howl. The movement is a Titan bird, blah, 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 blah. Any chance of a hidden chainsaw attachment, like the story trailer had? I hope you appreciated that. That was Mike's idea, by the way.
I appreciate it.
Mike, hey, can you give us more info about MechLab? Anything? What's there to say? I already said that we've got a developer working version that's not fit for public, right?
Yeah.
That's ugly and stuff. Anything else you could say about that?
You certainly can click on things and move some parts around. That's about where it's at for me.
You can fully customize a mech within its hard point limits and take it into a single-player skirmish match in our current build.
Then it's pretty cool. Working better than it was last week.
Welcome to game development, kids.
Oh, that's why.
More details, I don't know. In the overall design of our MechLab functionality, we definitely looked at Smurfy's online tool, if you're familiar with that. So it's not a one-to-one, but as a reference point, that might
That's
be
good. You got more information illuminated. Than you had now. I like it. Let's keep going. Let's see. Can we get patches for the mechs in the game? No. Well, maybe, but no. I just like saying no. Perhaps we've met. So I can't answer that question yet. Let's see. Dynamic day-night lighting and weather. Does it change during the mission, or is it just going to be a constant mission setting?
It does not change during the mission.
Yep. Okay. But
it does
pretty
change between missions for different maps that you play.
But we do have rolling clouds and stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The sunset. mood is just still my favorite.
That, yeah. If you look at our screenshots, that, you know, we use the sunset quite a bit because that's golden hour.
Exactly. Yeah. It's dramatic. You got it.
Every game does that. It's like, if you're going to put out a screenshot.
Let me show you my God Ray rendering.
Yes, exactly.
It helps with the complexion of the mechs because the lighting is.
Oh, here's a question I guess for me. Is it okay for me to wear a FASA shirt at the office? Well, here's the interesting thing about that. I can do whatever the fuck I want. That's the best thing about having your own company. Jordan likes when I wear this. He wears stuff from the virtual world.
Oh, so yeah. I've seen him, right? He's got the old school.
And by the way, if I may, I'm going to give you a little something here. Right? I don't know. So tell me if this is working.
Oh.
See that?
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. Nice. So that's my Mech Commander 1 shirt. That's pretty badass. Mech Commander 2, we had...
When you got
hockey
up and turned
shirts.
Your back to the camera, I was worried there.
Yeah, you thought I was going to drop.
You don't have to moon the audience.
I want to go back to that previous statement. I get to do whatever the fuck I want. All right, let's see. Are you guys going to be at MechCon 2017? You cannot keep us away. We had so much fun.
Oh, yeah.
That was a blast.
Oh,
that was great.
I should say, presuming our gracious host at Piranha.
Oh, they already wrote to me.
Oh, they did?
Yes.
Perfect.
Yeah. Sorry, that's how I knew. Yeah, they wrote to me and said, absolutely.
We're just
going to
show up and crash the party.
Yeah, hey, by the way, how's it going? HBS.
Love to. It was really fun.
Oh, God, that was a blast. First of all, I had no idea so many people would attend. But just the passion in the room, right? I mean, we make games specifically for the people in that room. And so to meet the people that really like what you're doing... It's the baddest ass thing.
It was very cool to see the room react.
I had like an hour and a half of two of the dev team for MechWarrior Online just chewing my ear, just like, what about this? What about this? What about the next thing? I'm answering as fast as I can. My goodness.
It was very cool to see the room react to Russ's sort of one more thing moment with the trailer.
That included me.
It's a lot. Oh, I know. I was like, oh, shit, this is happening.
Yeah, I knew it was coming, but it was kind of fun. No, it was still cool. Badass. Yeah. And the follow-up question was, will we be at Gen Con? Our Gen Con plans are still in the works, so we will neither confirm nor deny that we will be at Gen Con. I can only tell you that I will be at Gen Con.
Yeah.
It's Gen Con 50.
And Jordan, too.
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah. It's Gen Con 50. So we're attending no matter what, right? Let's see. What else? Okay, serious question this time. What coding language do you guys use for the game? It's C#.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there it is. That's a very serious answer.
And JSON for serialized data files.
Question was, do I have any Mech Commander tattoos on the bum? Not on the bum, but perhaps...
Nobody has confirmed.
Perhaps at the bikini line. No, but we all had the Shadowrun 2K17 got temporary Shadowrun tattoos at the party that I threw for the closing of the studio. That was kind of harsh. Anyway, question to Mitch. When the beta's on, can I fight you 1.1 stand in line, asshole? Next, any thoughts on mechanics for encouraging mixed loadouts?
Yes, lots of thoughts. So many thoughts, but maybe not ones that we're going to talk about just yet.
Yeah, but maybe someday on the forums you can type out your own thoughts or something.
Yeah.
That would be
no,
kind of interesting.
We're working with a lot of different ideas to figure out how to make autocannons, missiles, lasers, all that have unique roles on the battlefield. So it's not like, oh, this is always the dominant way to play. Let's
absolutely
always throw the heaviest things on we can, et cetera, et cetera.
Let's see. Oh, Glade Silverleaf, first time I've ever said anybody out here, but more art from Jen Tran, please. She rocks.
Yes.
And I agree.
If you go to my Twitter, /ADARAEL, I retweeted her fan art of the two characters from Yuri on Ice this morning. And it's totally this Yoshitaka Amano vibe. Just like, oh, Jen, you're so good.
Yeah. If you aren't following her on Twitter, I suggest you do, as well as Joel Duquet. I can't remember Joel's Twitter.
Cerulean Raven.
Cerulean Raven. That's with a C. And Jen's Jen Ravenna.
Jen Ravenna.
Jen Ravenna.
Jen's a print store up now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Check that out. All right. Let's see. How's the AI coming? That's from our little buddy Prussian Habit.
Coming?
It's coming. You know what? Mechs fight each other. The fun for me is when I press an attack on a mech and it jumps behind a building.
Oh, yeah.
Right? That's fun.
Yeah.
Or you press an attack on a mech and it jumps on you.
The AI is good at using jump.
Yeah.
I've noticed.
Let's see. Oh, here's a question from Krillin. Any ideas what's next after BattleTech? Yes. Okay, next question.
Sleep. a stiff drink.
A stiff drink. That's amusing as hell. No, it's a stiff drink, but in a mug. It's big. One of those BattleTech mugs. Let's see. When we fail a mission, will there be a big Atlas face with a tear on it? No, what we're going to get is the Joker mocking you over and over and over. I love that sort of, yeah, that goes back to Punch-Out with Bald Bull and Piston Hurricane. Or like, no mech with a tear. Let's see. Tyler, favorite weapon manufacturer?
Favorite weapon manufacturer?
We want to get really micro with this.
Okay, question. If we're going to get micro on this, I've got to dredge up my old mech warrior knowledge.
I'm going to let you, should I let you think of it?
The Sunbeam Corporation.
Because
the Sunbeam Corporation makes all of the high-powered energy long-range weapons for ground troops, and I always loved having a guy with a huge Sunbeam laser rifle.
All right, Mad 3R Marauder asks, now don't worry, this is not an ammo explosion question. Quite some time ago, there was talk about integrating a free ton of ammo into ballistic missile weapons. Any news on that front? Like, this is newsworthy.
I don't remember where we shook out on that, but I think that
I recall when I talked to Kiva about it, I think the way she wanted it was that you could launch a mech without ammo, and we'll throw up a dialogue saying, you realize you're going to launch this mech without ammo, and that's, you're right as an American.
There's no free ton of ammo anymore, just a warning that if you have no ammo, you might want to put some on
right.
your mech.
And by the way, to our friends from overseas who are staying up late and joining us, thank you very, very much. We really do appreciate you sticking around with us, and for each of these things every month. Let's see. Any plans for any European presence? I travel anywhere within Europe for you, but can't fly flying overseas. That comes from our friend Ian Drasari. And the answer is, I think Jordan is interested in heading to some con sometime, but jury's out on that. We can't, frankly,
we can't afford it either.
Right? All the money that we have
I will
is in BattleTech.
Being flown anywhere in Europe. But
we should kickstart that or something. You can do.
No, that's really more of a GoFundMe.
Yeah, GoFundMe. Yeah, send
maybe
Mike
anywhere
to
in Europe. Asterisk. I'm thinking about that.
Let's keep going before we get into international trouble. Let's see. Can you tell us about mission briefings or the mission briefing screen? Will it be voiced, animated, text only? You know, that kind of thing. And that comes from our little buddy, Commander Dunsell.
Hey, cool. Mission briefing screen, mostly. So there's kind of two parts. Like, you will be browsing the contract board in a system. You'll see kind of summary of different contracts you could take. Take a contract. Now you're looking at a more expanded view of the contract. Who's giving it? Negotiation options. And then if you launch that contract, you choose your lance, and then you see a briefing summary on the loading screen. All that's text and imagery in different formats. We may have some general data being read to you in voice, like
but not the whole thing.
Custom to the contract, but like
greetings, Mech Warriors.
Yeah, yeah.
You've been chosen by Zura and the Coward Conan. Fucking nerds. All right, good. Let's see what we got here. This is a good one. I like this one. Will we be able to set up asymmetric matches in PvP, like one player playing
Absolutely.
A single assault versus four lights?
Absolutely.
There's an option when creating a game to require a full lance or not.
Mm-hmm. Right. And once you uncheck that,
it's also an option to require stock mechs or not. Mm-hmm. So you can customize your match appropriately. I think it works though.
Yeah, I think it works.
In skirmish.
Yeah. Got a last Starfighter. Fuck yeah.
Oh.
let's see. What else we got? Any hope for the Archer making the cut?
I have no idea.
I don't think so.
No. They're happy about the stock mech option, by the way. What kind of... Let's see. Do you guys use a modular system for mechs and AI behavior, or does each mech have its own internal systems, code, and behaviors?
For AI?
Do individual mechs, I believe the question is, have their own specific AI?
No, it's a modular system built on roles on the battlefield that mechs can move into.
Yeah, if you've got a like a trebuchet out there and you've got a catapult out there, both of them are probably going to be hanging out in the sniper role because they are primarily missile boats. And if you get close, they'll fight you, but they'll try and keep their distance until they run out of ammo.
Another way to think about it is the AI logic does respond to the characteristics of the mech. It's not hard-coded to the mech. So because the trebuchet is a long-range boat with missiles, it will act in a way to make use of that.
Yeah, nobody wants to run up and brawl with a Jaeger mech.
No.
Well,
no.
I don't.
Although it is terribly satisfying to be the Jaeger mech. Sometimes you're the windshield, you know, and sometimes you're the bug. So regarding the main character in the game, right?
Commander.
You're commander. No.
You're player character.
Are you a silent protagonist, or are you Master Chief, like, I need a weapon?
No, you're a silent protagonist from an audio standpoint in story content. You do, like, so in between missions, if you're having conversations with your team, you do choose dialogue options, but they are not voiced.
If you've played a game called Shadowrun Returns or any good sequels, it's similar in fashion to that.
Let's see. Blah, blah, blah. Is the AI currently thinking only about individual mech, or does it think in regards to the, you know, at a strategic level, at all the mechs on the battlefield?
That's a good question.
It considers a lot of different stuff.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Proximity and...
All I know is that Dave is a
state of different mechs.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of stuff. All right. Just for the record, folks, we got 9 minutes left here. I'm looking for things that have more general appeal. Some of these things can be answered on battletech.game.com. Ask the dev forums for some of the more, you know, really minutia questions. I hope you understand. Here we go. All right. I would love to hear brutal, unabashed opinions on the Mech Assault games, if you're allowed to say. First of all, allowed to say? I think Mech Assault was fun in much the same way I think the Shadowrun 2K7 game was fun. There we go. What's everybody working on? I think that's a great question for you, Mike. You know, we know, that we've been working on code to get, you know, everything ready. But across the team, what sort of general high-level things are people working on simultaneously?
Sure. Combat's obviously a big focus right now, in particular... getting the multiplayer experience ready for prime time, the beta. Parallel path to that, we've got some pretty significant work going into our simulation game.
That's the mercenary game.
Yeah, it's the gameplay around the campaign, managing your crew.
The Oregon Trail portion.
Yeah, exactly. So there's a pretty cool event system that we're filling content into for that. And just, you know, infrastructure stuff we talked about a little bit in the
single-player story.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of story, just writing and content creation at this point.
Cinematics?
And cinematics and music.
There's stuff going on all over the place.
It's a big and. Welcome, welcome to
professional. Yeah, we got like...
This is not a small project. Yeah, it's about 35-ish. Yeah.
So a lot of art in particular is in sort of a full production track with map art, generating a lot of assets for new biomes so that can get into the hands of the design team soon. We've got vehicles in the pipeline. Mechs are actually really far along in both animation and effects, and textures are coming in now too.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, yeah, for my part, I've started a new project, which is mining.
Mining?
I'm mining a lot of salt today because of Ryan Burrell killing me repeatedly.
Yeah, somebody asked about that. How'd that taste?
Ah!
Sorry, pal. all right, let's keep going because we've only got 6 minutes left. There are plenty of good questions here. So do we have the story writing done, or are you still iterating about the flow and ending of the game?
We have a complete... high-level draft of the story that includes specific mission events and cinematics and everything. Mm-hmm. We are still iterating on the writing. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, we got first or second draft of cinematic scripts written, and Andrew's working on fleshing out all the actual, like, in-mission dialogue that would take place.
Right.
So it's all based on that outline that we've...
That's solid.
Oh, yeah, we've iterated on that thing.
We iterated the shit out of that. You measure four times, cut once.
But there's still the step of, okay, taking that and now, you know, Darius actually says this on the mission, and maybe then we have to react to that when we play missions. And generally, right. React means condense, and then
haiku, as we like to say, yeah,
make it count.
Yeah. All right. Good. Let's see. Here's one of those questions that actually I dislike, and so I want to get it out of the way early. No, it's one of those things, and this happens all the time in game development. One of the questions was, how long do you think this game will take to play, right? And there's never a good answer for it. We're never right. You know, we thought that Shadowrun Returns would take, you know, something in the neighborhood of 8 hours to play, and it took more like 15 or whatever. Mm-hmm. Dragonfall would take 15, it took 30 or whatever. So we don't know. And I don't see a real value in it other than to say that there are plenty of single-player campaign missions. There are plenty of procedurally generated mercenary missions. So that gameplay can go on for as long as you want. And then with multiplayer and skirmish mode, skirmish to me is this toy that I can pick up and play anytime. It's like Atlas versus my new loadout for, you know, whatever, the King Crab. King Crab's not in it.
That's just because you're too scared to go online and play multiplayer.
And then there's online multiplayer, which I'm not afraid of. I just suck. So there's no fear of
that. There's no fear. It's just knowledge. It's like, I waste everybody's time.
Yeah, including my own. I could just stay at home and suck at something else, right? So that's why that question doesn't have much value to me. The most important thing is, for the amount of money that we're charging for our video game, is there value?
Yeah.
And the way I, as a consumer, do it is I pay $10 to a ticket to a two-hour movie, right?
Yep.
And for $10, you can go to Steam and pick up Oh My God stuff. And so, really, what is your time worth? All right, moving on. Let's see. Can we get a leaderboard update every Q&A? Sure. Who's at the top right now? It's Ryan.
That's Maloney right now.
Yeah. Is it really?
But he's off having the baby.
So yeah, well, actually, he's off watching. So I just want to get that clear on where the real work
that is.
That
is a valid clarification.
Will there be true omnipods in mechs? No.
No, we're not. In the timeline for that currently.
All right. Let's see. Has anybody read any fan fiction?
I had fan fiction sent to me, as a matter of fact. Yeah. Granted, it's Death from Above fan fiction.
Yeah. Yeah, Paximo did some really nice Death from Above fan fiction. Other than that, the truth is that when we're not working, a lot of times we're reading stuff not about work, because we're humans. And
I finished a book last night.
Yeah, I saw that.
In the gut.
Yeah, brutal. Yeah, you were tweeting about that. By the way, where can we find you on Twitter?
At M. McCain, M-M-C-C-A-I-N. Very boring.
Let's see. In multiplayer, will there be grinding for mechs or equipment like World of Tanks, or will everything be available from the start?
Multiplayer, everything's available within the realm of whatever you selected for the match.
Yeah,
like
the only
stock mechs.
The only thing that you're grinding for is grinding for the pleasure of grinding other people's faces.
There we go. That's just a belief system for us. Just you bought the game.
You can have the stuff that's in the game.
Here. Yeah. Critter Tech, big question. Big question. Critter Tech.
Oh, wow, that's a blast.
Yeah.
Holy crap.
Let me just say, there are people that want that. And I can tell you.
Holly.
Yeah. Yeah. How awesome do you think the Commando is? We have some pretty good uses. Commando's a useful mech.
I had a Hunchback blown up in one salvo from a Commando this morning because he got around the rear arc. And it was like, well, if everything hits the center torso rear.
Yeah.
Commando's useful. It's not my favorite. Yeah. Just, I don't know what it is.
Prussian Havoc asks, and this one I think is from Mike, is there any more vertical slice development going on? And maybe we should define that because it's really not the right time for vertical slice anymore.
Yeah, and to be honest, like, we've been really making three games. So it's kind of at different points of the project for different parts of the project.
Well spoken.
Like the idea of here's the all-up BattleTech vertical slice doesn't exist, you know, won't exist. But combat's been through that. You know, we're working at, we've had sort of a first playable of the simulation game experience. Yeah. And then, you know, next up is probably story for a complete, like, first playthrough of story content. In the future here. So it's all kind of what is the next hill that it makes sense to take for each individual area of the project.
But we've spun a lot of plates simultaneously.
Yes.
Yeah. And by we, I mean him. I get to just watch and go, you know, spin that plate. You're like, I know. Thanks.
This way.
Yeah, let's see. Any news on which or how many mech variants there will be in the game? That's, you know, I got to tell you, that's not something we really think about. Like numbers and which ones. You know, there will be mech variants in the game. Yeah. There will be a fair number of mech variants in the game. But in terms of, like, what's the scope in that?
Yeah.
We really don't think about, and so we don't hold those numbers in our head. Please forgive us for that. It's just...
There's about 50.
Whoa, look at that. Well, look at you. When I say we don't have that number in our head, I'm not paid for that shit.
The other thing to consider is with our hardpoint system, if you've got, to use my previous example, the Hunchback, and you load it up, and there is a mech variant that you want that has an autocannon 10 rather than a 20, our hardpoint system lets you do that, so you don't have to buy the AC-10 version out of the box. Same deal with like the AC-10 to 20 swap on an urban mech.
And the variants that we do offer tend to provide different hardpoint options for the same mech.
Griffin N versus Griffin S, for example.
Let's see. Will you or are you opposed to releasing data sheets comparing all your mechs to one another with all the values and stuff?
If people want to get into the JSON once they've got the game, they can have that.
Yeah, there'll be data. We're not hiding.
Yeah, we're not hiding anything. We don't care. You know,
I doubt we'll put it on a PDF or something like that. But
yeah, but you can, you know, there are enterprising people out there that can figure this stuff out. But we don't have secrets. We're not trying to keep any. And, you know, we stand by our design decisions.
I trust that there will be a very thorough fan-made database.
You trust that? Launch. Maybe during beta.
Probably during beta, yeah.
Let's see. We are out of time, so let's try for one more question for each of us.
Oh, good.
What was your first mech game? Tyler Carpenter.
Like, first mech game?
Let's say mech and then say Battletech.
It was Battletech. It was the second edition box set. All of my friends bought AD&D first edition books, and I realized we didn't need six players' handbooks. So I bought the one with the giant robot on the cover, because I was like, I like giant robots, and I like Voltron. This looks like Voltron with missiles, so F yeah.
Mike?
My first mech game was Mission Force Cyberstorm. My second mech game was Mech Warrior 2, the vanilla campaign.
Vanilla?
Vanilla's well, then there was Ghost Bear's Legacy, there was Mech Warrior 2 Mercenaries, which I also played.
But. Yeah, me too. My very first Battletech game was the Battle Droids. dated. And that there it is. And then I didn't play a video game until Mech Warrior 2 because when I saw the whole 3D acceleration thing, because that's what we called it at the time.
Yeah. Oh, that was... They packaged that with graphics cards?
They did.
Yeah,
I recall picking up the triple box set of Crescent Hawk's Inception, Revenge, and Mech Warrior 1.
Yep.
Like the big yellow and red box.
Absolutely.
I was laying around somewhere.
I was making children's games when Mech Warrior 2 came out. And it was soon after that that Jordan and I talked. Like, you know.
We could do a thing.
Yeah. All right, let me just see if there's anything
else. Explosions on the box.
That's it. Slide to unlock. Oh, let me guess. I'm hoping it's 0000.
It is!
All right. Can we meet Hans Davion, Maximilian Lau, or other leaders in our game?
They're a bit above your pay grade as mercenaries in the periphery.
Not this version of the game. It's like saying, may I please walk up to Donald Trump in SOCOM?
There are some fairly well-known people that may make appearances, but well-known in that fashion that I've used them on Death from Above.
There you go. Anyway, on that note, it is after 1 o'clock. That means we are at the end of another monthly live stream Battletech development Q&A from... Harebrained Scheme Studios in sunny-ish Seattle, hosted by our friends at No Guts, No Galaxy. Thank you guys very much, Darren and Phil. We love you guys, and we really appreciate the support. To everybody out there, a couple things. Remember, BattletechGame.com. Go there. We're there all the time answering questions. There's a great environment there for people to hang out. Also, we want to make sure that you tune in to Death From Above every Friday at 6 p.m. Pacific time on HyperRPG. That's on Twitch. Anything else we should add here, kids? No?
That's the show.
Yep, we love you. We're going back to work. Cheers.
Godspeed, gentlemen.
Peace out. And then mute that down.